Well, good morning and happy Father's Day. If nobody's told you that yet, happy Father's Day, Dad. Appreciate you taking some time out of your day today to spend with us, and I pray that you're going to be blessed. I told you last week that I set out to write a series for men. I've become, you read the paper every day and you see another man failing. Some of these men are heroes of mine, or people that I admire that I see making decisions that just kind of baffles the mind. So I wanted to write a series for men, to get men back on track. And I thought if there was just three areas of our lives that men would become more dedicated, that the world would change. That if men would simply become men of faith, men of family, and men of character, that the world would be a better place to live in. Now, last week we talked about being a man of faith and being willing to follow God's plan through it all. And we learned that it's okay to pray, God, will you take this thing away? But at some point we have to move past, God, will you take this thing away, to God, I trust you, and not my will, but yours be done. This week, it's Father's Day, so I wanted to look at becoming a man of family. And most specifically today, I want to talk to husbands. Now, it's Father's Day, so why in the world wouldn't we be talking to fathers today? Why husbands? Well, I believe it's pretty apparent through Scripture, and I hope walking out of here today, you're going to see that it's apparent that the nucleus that holds the family together is the husband. Before you're ever a father, you're a husband. And it's the husband that has this massive responsibility of being the nucleus of the family. In my ministry and in counseling, I've met so many men who are great dads, but terrible husbands. But rarely have I run across a gentleman who's a great husband, but a terrible dad. See, it kind of goes hand in hand. It's kind of in succession, one after another, that to become a great dad, you got to be a great husband. Now, before you groan and say, oh gosh, I've sat through these husband sermons before. Here comes Dr. Romance, and he's going to tell me that I don't bring flowers to my wife enough, and I don't hold the door open for her enough, and blah, 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 right? We've all sat through those messages. Well, let me just go ahead and tell you, you probably don't do those things enough. And you don't need the Bible to tell you that, right? Most of us probably lack a little bit in those areas. But this is not one of those sermons. Let me just kind of set you at ease. This is not one of those sermons, and I am certainly not Dr. Romance. In fact, I am probably the least romantic person in this room if we took a poll and if we went around and wrote stories. I'm the guy who actually proposed to his wife by walking out of a bathroom and holding a ring and saying, here, I found this under the urinal, do you want it? Those aren't the ones you put on YouTube, right, that get all these clicks. I'm the guy who made sure that we got married on July 31st, before August 1st. You know why that was important to me? Because August is where football season starts. And I wanted to get the marriage out of the way and the honeymoon and all that other mess that goes with it out of the way before football season starts, right? So I'm not Dr. Romance. You don't have to worry about that being one of those kind of messages this morning. But let me say this before we get going. I know that a message like this can sometimes bring up feelings that aren't positive. And let me say this about that. First of all, we're not here to talk about the past. If you're a guy that's sitting in here and there's a failed marriage in your past, this is not one of those messages that's here to beat you up and to make you feel guilty and to make you feel like there were things that you didn't do that you should have done. If I've learned anything in ministry and in counseling, it's that marriage is a two-way street, and I completely understand that. So we're not here to talk about the past. We're talking about moving forward. That if you aspire to be a husband, this is the husband that you need to aspire to be. If you're a husband today, this is the husband you need to work towards being. If you're a young woman in here and you hope to get married someday, I pray that you will not settle for anything less than what we're going to talk about in here today. If you're a wife in here and you don't have this husband yet, I pray that we give you some traction on how to pray and how to help your husband become the husband that God wants him to be. The real tragedy, I believe, in the American society today as we turn on the news and we see all these things going wrong, I think it really boils down to the failure of the American family. And the funny thing about that is America loves family. We want families. We desire to be part of a family growing up. Most of the shows on television revolve around family in some way or another. We seek to start our own family when we become adults. We live in a society where 96% of men and 94% of women will all at some point in their lives say, "I do." But sadly, over half of them at some point are going to say, "But I don't anymore." Over 90% of Americans desire to get married and seek out a marriage of their own, maybe even something they dream of their whole life, only to watch it crumble and fade away and watch that dream ultimately turn into a nightmare. Now, the good news is, just because it's become the norm in our society, it definitely doesn't have to become the result for you. I don't know who you are. I don't know a lot about many people in here, but I do know this. God wants you to stay married. God desires that you would stay married. God not only wants you to stay married, He wants you to find satisfaction and joy and fulfillment through your marriage. God wants you to grow closer to Him because of your marriage. Because of that, God gives us a blueprint for marriage, step-by-step directions to marriage and building a family. And do you know what He said was the nails that hold it all together? Who's the cog that spins everything and keeps it moving? It's the husband in the house. It's the man of the house. He said, "On you I put this huge burden of holding this thing called marriage together." In Ephesians chapter 5, He says, "Here's how you do it. I'm not just going to tell you to do it and not leave you some instructions. Here, sir, is how you do it. Here is where the rest of your life with your wife begins." We're in Ephesians chapter 5 this morning, and I'm going to start in verse 25. I want to read the whole passage, and then we're going to kind of break it down after that. But listen to this. This is how God says a marriage ought to look to a man and a woman. "Husbands, love your wives just as Christ loved the church and gave Himself up for her to make her holy, cleansing her by the washing with water through the word, and to present her to Himself as a radiant church without stain or wrinkle or any other blemish, but holy and blameless. In this same way, husbands ought to love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. After all, no one ever hated his own body, but he feeds and cares for it, just as Christ does the church. For we are members of his body. For this reason," some of you probably heard this in your marriage ceremony. "For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. This is a profound mystery, but I'm talking about Christ and the church. However, each one of you must love his wife as he loves himself, and the wife must respect her husband." Now, in those 9 verses, there was one word that Paul used 7 times that is the essence of how God wants the husband to treat his wife. And that word that's used 7 times in there is a very simple word. It's a 4-letter word, L-O-V-E, love. He says 7 times that the husband is to love his wife. Now, if you're like me, you're probably saying, "Come on, man. I got up this morning and I got dressed to come in here and hear this." Well, of course we're supposed to love our wives. We get that part of it. I mean, we're not a bunch of dopes in here. Of course we're supposed to love our wives. Yeah, we know all that. But what does it mean to love our wife? You see, we live in a society where the word love gets thrown around a lot. And it's been watered down by being thrown around so much that we don't even know, I think, what the word love means anymore. See, we men will say, we love a big old juicy steak, right? We love a big old juicy steak. We love power tools. We love our new car. We love the Atlanta Falcons. We love Schwarzenegger movies. We love deer hunting. We love guitars. Whatever it is that you're into, we love those things. And, of course, I love my wife. But see, that's not it. We've missed the mark. See, to use the word love in that sense means my wife is equivalent to a big old juicy steak. Or my car. or by power tools or that big old buck in the woods. And I know you think to yourself, well, wait a minute, that's not what I mean. Yes, I've said that before, but that's not what I mean. I know. What we mean when we say that we love these things, like a steak or a car or a job or things like that, what we mean when we say those things is I love the feeling that I get from these things. You love the feeling that these things give you. In other words, our job meets our need to be challenged. Our car meets our need to feel younger or luxurious. Our team meets our need to be a part of something bigger than ourselves, to feel like a winner. Our steak meets our need to feel satisfied physically. But what happens when we get tired of eating steak? We try some chicken, right? What happens when that car that we used to love is now out of style and breaks down every now and then? We'll trade it in for a new model, right? What happens when that job is no longer a challenge, but it's just a grind that you get up and have to do every day? You'll move on and do something different, right? Well, all too often in that same context, man loves his wife. But because of a misunderstanding of the meaning of love, what he really means is this woman, she meets my needs. She meets my needs for respect. She meets my need for companionship. She meets my need for emotional attachment. She meets my need for physical desires. And when that feeling goes away or the met need ceases to be met anymore, sadly, many men will start thinking about trading her in for a new model or going to find a new challenge or seeking elsewhere to get that feeling that he used to get. And that's why so many men will walk away from their homes because they never loved their wife. They just liked the feeling they got from their wife. They enjoyed the feeling. You know, the rock group Boston once sang, it's more than a feeling, right? It's more than a feeling. See, guys, love is not an adverb that describes the feeling you get from your wife. Love is an action word. Love is never static. Love is always doing something. Love is always at work. In fact, I will tell you, from 25 years of marriage, love is a ton of work. It's a ton of hard work. Love is not an adverb to describe something. Love is a verb in how you do something. Paul said it this way in 1 Corinthians chapter 13. Again, if you had a marriage ceremony in a church with a pastor, I will guarantee you he read this passage to you. 1 Corinthians 13. Paul said, love is all these things and is always fighting to not be these other things. And I want you to see all the things that love is constantly doing. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love does not envy. It is not boastful. It's not arrogant. It's not rude. It's not self-seeking. It's not easily angered. It's constantly working to not be those things. Love forgives. Love protects. Love trusts. Love hopes. Love perseveres. Love does not fail. See, all those things love is constantly doing. Love is not an adverb to describe the feeling I get from my wife. Love is doing all these things or protecting myself from not doing these things. See, love is always doing something. It's always on the move. It's always at work. And when I look at that, I don't love my car like that. I don't love my job like that, surely. And I don't even think I love the Atlanta Falcons like that. In fact, I don't think when I look at that, I'm not even sure I have the ability to love like that. I'm not even sure that's within me. Well, you don't have that ability. But supernaturally placed in everyone who knows Christ is that ability through him to love somebody like that. In fact, he's even given us the example that we're to follow. Look at verse 25 with me again. Husbands, love your wives just as Christ loved the church. It says we're to love our wives as Christ loved the church. Now that word love in this passage is very, very interesting. If you've been in church seminars, couple seminars, at any point in time, you've probably seen this broken down. There are several different Greek words that are used and translated into the word love throughout the Bible. There's the Greek word phileo, which means a friendship type of love, or a brotherly type of love, or a companionship type of love. It's you can probably put this together. It's where the city of Philadelphia gets its name, and that's why it's called the city of brotherly love, phileo. But that's not the word that's used right here for love. There's a second word that's used oftentimes in the Bible for love, and it's the Greek word eros. And that's the type of love that means a passionate love or a sensual love or a sexual type of love. And when he's talking about the husband loving his wife, surely that's the word he uses, right? I mean, surely, isn't that why we all got married in the first place, right? Because we were all hot and bothered and we wanted it to be all right with everybody that we were doing these things, right? But that's not the word that he uses here. No, the word that he uses here is the word agape. Agape is a type of love that is so much deeper than friendship or family or passionate romance. And fellas, it's the love that your wife is desperate for. It's what she needs. It's what she wants. It's what she dreams about. It is what she was designed to crave. And the only way to show that kind of love is to model the love that Jesus shows to you and me. So let's break down what this love is all about. What in the world is this agape love? And as we go through this, I pray that not only that you will see how the husband is to love the wife, but I pray that you can see through this the incredible love that Jesus has for you and me. First of all, agape love is sacrificial love. It's sacrificial. Look at verse 25 again. Husbands, love your wives just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. So how do we love our wives? Like Christ loved us, the church, and gave himself up for her. Now that's pretty clear, isn't it? It's the love of self-sacrifice. It's the love of giving it all up. Do you realize the sacrifice that Christ made for you and me? Jesus left his throne in heaven. He tore off his robes. He threw down his crown. He came all the way to earth to be one of us, to walk like us, to talk like us. He didn't have to. He chose to out of love. He lived a life of poverty and rejection and betrayal. He didn't have to. He chose to out of love. There had to be a sacrifice for my sin, and there had to be a sacrifice for your sin, and he was the only one qualified. He was the only one perfect, so he allowed himself to be betrayed, to be treated with shame, to be broken, to be spat upon, to be mocked. He allowed himself to be hung by his hands and by his feet and nailed to a cross, bleeding and suffering and dying in the cruelest way man has ever devised to execute another human being, not because he had to, because he was overwhelmed with love, because he was so overwhelmed with love for you and me that he was willing to give up everything he had to sacrifice it all for those that he loves. And guys, he says you and me are to love our wives with that same kind of love, with love that is a cross, with love that is Calvary. Men, would you be willing to go to Calvary for your wife? Now, let me just say this. You can't be her Savior. She's got one, and his name is Jesus, and that's the only one she's ever going to have. But you can love her like her Savior. It's very interesting in the Bible, if you study relationships in the Bible and all the commands that God gives to the husband and the wives, it's very interesting that there's never a command that the wife is to love the husband. It's not in there. It's only for the husband to love the wife. The command for men is love. The command for women is respect. That's very, very interesting. Now, that doesn't mean she shouldn't love him, but the intention is that she will return something that is related directly to what she is receiving. Men, our job is to love our wives like Christ loves us. Nowhere does it say that you are to love your wife as long as she is loving you back. Nowhere does it say you are to love your wife when she is being her most lovable. See, Jesus went to the cross Not because we loved him so much. Get your mind around this. Jesus didn't go to the cross because we loved him so much. Jesus went to the cross because he loved us so much. And I assure you, it's not because we're so lovable. Right? Do you think that as they beat him and kicked him and mocked him that Jesus thought, oh gosh, these people are so wonderful. That this is the least I can do for these people. They are so great. They're so wonderful and lovable that this is the least I can do for them. Sir, you don't love your wife because she loves you. You love her so she will love you. You don't love your wife because she's always right. You love your wife to make her right. See, Jesus loved the church to death. Jesus loved the church until it killed him. Anybody see where this is going? You are to love your wife until it kills you. The price tag on love is extremely high, and that's why so many men are unwilling to pay the price and walk away. But Scott, you don't understand. I've given up everything for that woman. You don't understand. You don't know what I've been through. I've given up everything I can possibly give up for that woman. Well, are you still breathing? Then you haven't given up everything. See, the point is, we're praying to God to give us some men that will stick it out. To give us some men that will say, I'm not going anywhere. That will give and give and give until nothing is left to give, because love, agape love, is sacrifice. It's sacrificial love. The second thing agape love is it's sanctifying love. Sanctifying love. Verse 25 again. Husbands, love your wives just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her to make her holy, cleansing her by washing with water through the word, and to present her to himself as a radiant church without stain or wrinkle or any other blemish, but holy and blameless. Jesus' love for me cleanses me. Even in the midst of my most vile sin, Jesus has cleansed me of that and made me holy. Now, holy is one of those church words, right, that we throw around, and everybody, when you hear holy, you nod your head because you know it's something that's supposed to be really good, but none of us really actually understand what in the world the word holy means in the first place. Holy means, very simply, that Jesus took me and set me apart. He has sanctified me for a special use. He has taken me and he has cut me from the herd and he has set me apart. It's kind of like, if you've seen the movie Titanic, it's like the movie Titanic at the very end when the camera pans out and you just see the wreckage and you see all those dead bodies just floating in the water. That I was one of those dead bodies at one time. But for some reason, out of the midst of all those dead bodies, Jesus reached down, he picked my body out, he breathed life into me, and he gave me a purpose and a direction for my life. He cut me from the herd. He took me and he set me apart and he sanctified me. He took me from where I was, which was nowhere, to where I am going, which is anywhere. Men, in the same way, you picked out that woman to be your wife. You cut her from the herd of millions and millions and millions of women in the world, and you said, that one is mine. I cut her from the rest of the herd, and I take her to be mine. And now marriage is to be the purifying experience. Marriage takes the woman and separates her from all others to the husband. Now, sir, it is your job to maintain that purity. It is your job, sir, to work at the marriage by setting her apart through love and moving the marriage to where it needs to go. She's not just some woman. She is your wife who has been set apart from the herd for you. Now sanctify her with your love. Here's something we have to get through our head and into our hearts right now. When you married her, sir, and I've had these conversations in counseling sessions. When you married her, you married all of her. You married every bit of her. You married the good. You married the bad. And you married the ugly. right? You married it all. You married her for better and worse. You married her for richer and poor. You married her in sickness and in health. You married her for skinny and not skinny anymore. You married her for no kids days, and you married her for the days that she's been chasing kids all day. You married her for makeup, and you married her for not makeup. You married her temper. You married her attitude. You married her demeanor. You married her past. You married her family. You married all of it. You got the whole package, brother. And so many men get married and say, whoa, I didn't sign up for all this. This isn't what I thought it'd be. I'm out of here. She's crazy. Well, you married her for crazy. She's angry. Well, you married her for angry. She's lazy. Well, you married her for lazy. Sir, set her apart. Sanctify her. You are in the home what Jesus is to the church. If something's wrong, it is your job to sacrifice and fix it. When she is discouraged, you encourage. When she is down, you get up. When she is mad, you get glad. When her world comes crashing down, you stick out your big old male arms and you hold the world over her on your shoulders. Sanctifying love. I'll tell you something else about sanctifying love. It keeps no record of wrong. Three most sanctifying words that you can utter in a marriage are not, I love you. You know what the three most sanctifying words you can utter in a marriage? I forgive you. I forgive you. Chuck Gordon gave one of the greatest sermon illustrations I've ever seen on forgiveness in the marriage. And some of you probably weren't even here yet. It was when we were still at the other school. I'll never forget it. It just sticks out in my mind. He was wearing a shirt, and he took ketchup and mustard, and he poured it all over himself. And he said, "This is the argument we have, okay?" And then he took the shirt off, and he said, "When you forgive, you're allowed to take the shirt off." And he took the shirt off, and he put it on a rack over here, and he went on, and he continued on with his message, and he said, "Here's the mistake that most families will make." The husband or the wife will go back to the rack and pull that shirt off and say, "Remember this? What we've got to do is throw it out." The most sanctifying words in a marriage, listen to me, the most sanctifying words in a relationship of any kind, I don't care what kind of relationship you're in, are "I forgive you." Hard to say. Freeing to say. Sanctifying husband seeks holiness for her, seeks purity for her. Instead of dragging that old stuff back up, he says, like Christ, "I'm going to sacrifice to make sure you never, ever have to feel that way again." Verse 27 says, "We're to present our wives as Christ presents the church, radiantly in all her glory, having no stain or blemish, but she should be holy and blameless." That's her beauty. It's not her looks and it's not her clothes. It's her beauty. Purity, that's her beauty. Now, let me say this about looks and clothes. Hey, listen, we're visual guys, okay? Ladies, do the best with what you got. I believe in that, okay? But at the end of the day, that's not your beauty. Your beauty is your purity. There's no place for shaming her. There's no place for degrading her. There's no place for criticizing her. She's to be lifted up for her purity. Her holiness is her beauty. So the husband, like Jesus, should seek to present the bride exalted, pure, honored. That's sanctifying love. Agape love is sacrificial, it's sanctifying. Number three, it's satisfying. Verse 28, it's where it kind of takes a little bit of a turn here. "In this same way, husbands ought to love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. After all, no one ever hated his own body, but he feeds and cares for it just as Christ does the church, for we are members of his body." Love your wife as your own body. Love your wife as you love yourself. We take care of the needs of our own body, right? When we're sick, we get rest. When we're hungry, we get something to eat. When we're thirsty, we get something to drink. When we're dirty, we clean it. Eventually, right? We take care of our bodies. We're called to take care of the needs of our wives in the same way we take care of the needs of our own bodies. We're called to devote ourselves to catering to the needs of our wives. Now look at verse 31. For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. When you got married, I hope some pastor who married you explained this to you, that you become one flesh, one body. If her needs get met, your needs get met. You take care of her, she takes care of you. But if her needs aren't met, then brother, I assure you, yours won't be either, because you are one with each other. You take care of her because of this oneness. To be a fulfilled husband, it takes fulfilling the wife. Hey, that old saying, happy wife, happy life, there's some truth in that. Because you're one. If one half of your body is not happy, you will not be happy. 50% happy ain't happy. So if you want a blessed marriage, take care of your wife. Satisfy her needs. She's not your cook. She's not your dishwasher. She's not your babysitter. She's not your sex partner. She is your God-given treasure, your queen. She is the other half of you. Now, there's a couple of really descriptive words in verse 29. Feeds comes from a Greek word that means to nourish. It's a word that's often used to describe the raising of children. Do you picture your wife that way? One who needs to be nourished by you, most men will say that's not my responsibility. God says it is. There's another word in there, verse 29, care. Care for their bodies. That comes from a Greek word that means to cherish. Literally, it means to warm the body with heat. It's often used to describing a mother bird covering her babies with her feathers. It means for us to provide a nest of warmth and security to support her and to care for her. You're the nourisher in the house. You're the protector in the house. You're the supporter in the house. You're the backbone of the house. Verse 30 says, because we are members of his body. Jesus does it for us because when we accept him in faith, we become one with him. We do it with our wives because we have become one with them. Satisfy her needs or commit suicide to half of your body because you're one. You joined one flesh. It's a sacrificing love. It's a satisfying love. It's a sanctifying love. Fourth and finally, agape love is a securing love. Look at verse 31 again. For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. That word united comes from a word that means glued to, stuck to. You're stuck with each other. You're stuck together. Guys, she's got to know and she's got to feel secure that you will never break that intimate bond of oneness, that you will never bring in a glue solvent to separate you from her, that you are glued to her, that you are stuck to her. Listen, we are not going to wake up tomorrow and find out that Jesus is gone. We're not going to wake up tomorrow and find a note on the pillow that Jesus wrote that said, you know what? I just can't take this relationship anymore. You have frustrated me to the point that I cannot be in this relationship anymore. And I got to believe, just from talking from me, Jesus feels that way about me sometimes. I cannot do this anymore. That one sin that I've told you do not do, you keep going back and doing it and doing it and doing it again. I cannot do this anymore. I'm out of here. We will never wake up and find Jesus has left us that note. When you invite Jesus into your heart to be your Savior, he says, there is nothing you can do to run me out of your life. There is no sin so big, no word so hurtful, no age so useless where Jesus says, I'm out of here. Your wife has got to know that you have got that same securing love for her. I know we've hit a rough patch. I know it looks bad. I don't even know how we're going to fix this right now, darling. But you need to know I'm not going anywhere and I'm willing to die trying to move this marriage to being all that it can possibly be. Because I'm going to love you sacrificially. I'm going to love you with a sanctifying love that purifies. I'm going to work to satisfy your every need and be secure because I'm not going anywhere. Now, men, this is a pretty simple message, but it's huge. It's big. I believe the success of our society hinges on a message like this. I truly do. And I know when you hear something like this, it probably seems a little unrealistic. It is. Agape love is impossible for you and me. It can only be done if Jesus Christ is living through you. It can only be achieved if you are in a relationship with Jesus Christ by accepting Him into your heart as Lord and Savior. And if you don't completely understand what that means, we've got a place in the back after this service. It's called the Care and Prayer Area. I wish you would go ask somebody. I'm not sure what it means to be in a relationship with Jesus, but I'd love to explore it just a little bit more. We've got folks there that would love to talk to you, pray with you, any questions that you have. And let me also say this about agape love. As hard as agape love is to give, it's equally as hard to receive. You can hear a message like this and walk out of here all pumped up and say, it's going to be different in my house today. And you know what? She's probably going to know, well, he's just doing this because he heard it today. He'll be the same tomorrow. Or she'll wonder what your motives are. Or maybe she'll just reject it altogether. Let me say this about that. Jesus walked this earth for 3 years, spreading agape love everywhere he went, leaving agape love behind everywhere he went, and virtually nobody accepted it. But one night, sitting at the Passover meal, talked about it a little bit last week, Jesus looked at those who had, for the most part, tried to accept that love from him, and he said, I want you to understand, I'm about to do something that is going to be, leave no doubt in anybody's mind how much I love you. So that you will know that you know that you know, and generations will know after that I love you. Men, it is with that patience that we're to go home and we're to love our wives like Christ loves the church. Let's pray.